The Origin of the World. A talk given by Venerable Kesari Dhammananda Thera at the University of Agriculture. I think this is the first time I was managed to see such a large gathering here. But in English, the universe is very big. One, there are many occasions where the Buddha has completely rejected to talk anything about the universe. Even then, there are no certain occasions he had to touch upon on this subject by observing the understanding capacity of the Christian. The Buddha did not answer to many questions because he knew the Christians cannot understand. A small child can ask very superior questions, but father and mother never know to explain on this day. This is unbelievable. It's exactly that. Coming to this world or the becoming a Buddha is only for two purposes. That is his mission. To tell you why you suffer here in this world and to tell you how to get free of this suffering. Now that is the purpose of this mission. So he did not come to this world to tell you where this world or the universe or originated or created or when will be the end of this. He says there is no religious value whatsoever by knowing when this world comes into existence or when it ends. By knowing the nature of the whole universe, we cannot become religious. All our ignorance, our pain, our jealousy, our anger, our human weaknesses remain as we are. Changes never take place in the man's mind to be good, to be religious, by knowing the nature of the whole universe. Anyway, let us try to find out whether the Buddha has mentioned anything. How this world or the universe come into existence. Although we use the word universe, there are universes, not only one universe. In certain discourses, the Buddha has said, there are thousands of suns and thousands of moons and thousands of world systems where there are human beings exist. We cannot understand. But today, astronomers and scientists acknowledge, accept, definitely there are many suns, many moons. And they also believe there are human beings in certain other planets or worlds, although they are not made. They have no doubt. In one galaxy, there are millions of stars of matter. Among those millions, there are at least few thousands where there are different types of universes. In the first discourse of the Buddha, Dhamma Sutta, another Mahasamaya, well-known sutra, Dasa Sahasri Loka Dhatu, 10,000 world systems, he mentioned, the living beings appear, representatives from 10,000. So that means he has acknowledged and explained that there are living beings in other planets. Now, the most important thing is this. How this world, let us take only one particular planet, this Earth, how this world comes into existence at the beginning? Whether the Buddha has said anything? Anamatabhoya vikave samsara upabhavati na parinayati. This is the advice used by the Buddha. He used one word, samsara. Samsara means wheel of existence. Repeated birth and death is called samsara. He says there is neither beginning nor end. But we could not understand why he said like this. Very sensitive. Modern science also supports us. Either life, or elements, or matter, cannot exist alone. All these existing things and life are interrelated. Interdependent. Albert Einstein's relativity explains this very clearly. A single item cannot exist alone, cannot come into existence without depending on something. Then where is the beginning? The beginning that we saw, that we have found out, the end of energy. We cannot understand. Something comes into existence when end of energy happens. That's why it's called interrelated, dependent. Frictions of certain things or two things produce energy. And that is the beginning. The Buddha started with nama and rupa, mind and matter. The combinations of mind and matter conditions a life. The combinations of certain elements and energies produce plants and various other objects, but no mind. Then, the beginning of the world, the Buddha says there are four periods. Samvartha, Samvartha Sthayi, Vivartha, Vivartha Sthayi. One period remains an existing period. Now the world is existing. Living beings exist. Matters and elements exist. This is one period. After that, the second period starts, deteriorating period. All these existing things, living things, matters, are going on deteriorating, declining, slowly going down and down and down and down. This is just the head. Scientifically, this one has been proved recently. All of you know as university students that the beginning that we take of as atomic energy. We take this is the beginning of matter. When we define this atom or atomic energy, three more energies, electron, neutron, proton. The combinations of the energies of these three things bind together, then we give one name, atom. Every living thing, life, plants, animals, depend on atom. Today, scientists have decided proton, a starter to the deteriorate, fading away. We may take millions of years to complete. When this particular energy is deteriorated, the other two energies cannot exist, cannot function properly. See, scientifically, deterioration started on it. Then, end of the world, happy day one. Our end of that day, according to the book, remaining completely empty space, but not the whole universe, remember. The whole universe will disappear at once. In certain areas in this space, certain planets, going on deteriorating, and everything. But other things, in one galaxy, many planets or stars disappear, but the rest remain. This is the nature of the universe. Again, new planets, new stars always appear. Not at once. It takes for a long period for us to see. And this one. Now, during the third period, a space remains without a world here. Then what happened to the existing elements and energies and living beings? This is the biggest problem. What happened to you? I told you just now, when one section of this universe is completely deteriorated or disappeared, but there is nobody to destroy. There is no person to destroy. So all these living beings appear in certain other planets where there are living beings. So the life exists again in certain other planets. Assume. Now this one is completely disappeared. Then what happened? During this period, all these dispersed particles, molecules, gravity, energies, going on accumulating, may take millions of years. Then slowly the formation takes place. After this formation, environment, atmosphere, and the plant life, and animals, and everything are ready, available for life to appear again. The life has started. And how this first life, not one or two, come here? After the formation of this particular world, this globe, other religions say something. But Buddhists cannot take it. Before they started to tell us how this world comes into existence, how life comes into existence, the Buddha has mentioned this more than 2,500 years ago. Record in history. According to them, somebody created this life too. World is created within few days, right? The world is created, life is created within few days, right? Now let us refer to historians like S.G. Wells, what he says. When you read his book, you can understand. He says, when you study geology or geography, we can understand it has taken for millions of years to cool down this globe, for life to exist. But our holy book says, God has created everything within 1 week. And this is the way our historians explain. Now here what the Buddha says. Formation takes place, and to settle down everything may take millions of years earlier than that. So still I did not tell you how this life comes into existence at the beginning. Whether somebody created this life or appeared or made. Remember, living beings are there in other planets. They also die. They are not permanent or eternal or immortal. After their death, when the situation, atmosphere, circumstances are favorable, yet departed person's consciousness, mental energy, again absorbed into all these existing elemental energies. Cosmic energies exist here. Mental energy and consciousness transmit. When it is transmitted, absorbed. Now let us see what the Buddha again, what he says, how rebirth takes place. Vijnana matupukshismi oktamaj. The departed consciousness, remember in that consciousness, mental energy, karmic energy, good and bad karmic energy, failing, attachment, all these ingredients are there. It is not mere mental energy. When the attachment towards this particular part of the world or the universe works like magnetic power, this is called grasping energy in the man's mind. After our death, that grasping energy, attachment, craving, in that consciousness. So, absorb. When various types of living beings come into existence according to their mentality, karmic energy, attachment, inclination. Are they? Human beings, animals, earthlings, all the other living beings come into existence according to their previous karmic energy, karmic process. There is nobody to create the individual here in this world. Are now existing to you. And these are the four periods explained by the Buddha. So the scientific interpretation gives full support for this interpretation. No controversy. When you refer to Ajnana Sutra, where the Buddha has mentioned about the beginning of the world, it is mentioned there, after destruction of this world, when the formation has taken place, two Brahmas from the Brahma world, the higher and deva, come down from the Brahma world, and after that, they take the cream here. The whole earth is covered with very fragrant, very tempting cream. Then after that, they eat it. After eating this, they develop their craving towards this, attachment towards this. With Adam and Eve and apple business idea originated from there. They change the word that cream into apple, that's all. So they have learned this from the Buddha. Because this is a story they have read to us less than 2,000 years. But the Buddha has given this more than 2,500 years ago. So after developing this training, attachment, inclination, they have lost the miraculous power that they had. So they could not go back. So they have to settle down. So at the beginning, there was no sex formation. They had no sex. When they developed this craving and attachment and many other things slowly, changes start to take place in the physical body also.
Later, sex organs also started to develop.
Because of that thing, then they started jealousy, anger, various other human defilements in the mind because of this thing. That is why we point out, craving is the main cause for all our problems that we are facing. Craving is responsible for our enjoyment, pleasant and unpleasant feelings. Those who are free from this craving never experience fear, jealousy, anger, misunderstanding, envy.
Anyway, some other scholars say that this is a mythological interpretation of the departed person's consciousness from the other planets, because there are living beings in the other planets also.
31 planes of existence. The whole universe, the Buddha has categorized into 31 groups. Different kinds of living beings. A spirit, ghost, human beings, animals, different kinds of devas, gods, different kinds of brahmas, and hell. 31 places where there are living beings. they experience pleasant and unpleasant feeling.
In one of those 31 planes of existence,
there are different types of living beings according to their good and bad times. Now you know how animals experience their life. You know how human beings experience their life. And invisible living beings such as spirits and ghosts, how they experience the other children. We have created our own imagination, but we cannot deny their existence. And devas and brahmas in various other planets where they exist, they too have pleasant and unpleasant experience, but more pleasant and worldly pleasures. But all are impermanent, subject to this universal law of impermanency. There is no eternal life anywhere in any part of the universe. The Buddhist concept of heaven and hell is entirely different. First thing, they are not everlasting or permanent, changeable. They are reached at time limit according to their good and bad karma, very adjustable. And hell is not located or situated in a particular area, under this earth or under the great oceans or somewhere else. And heaven is not situated in one particular area. Everywhere where there are living beings, they experience heavenliness and hellfire. Let us use the word hellfire. Human beings also experience both. Animals also experience both. Some other living beings also experience both. Devas and Brahmas also experience more heaviness and little bit of hellfireness also. Because they have worries, they have miseries, they have grievances, not free. So Buddhist concept of heaven and hell is very clear, not located in one particular area, wherever life exists, those living beings also experience heavenliness as well as hellfire. And they are not permanent, but changed. Rebirth again takes place in certain other places. So when we use the word universe, all these 31 planes of existence are included here in this world. Just now I told you, there are universes, not only one, universe, infinite. There is neither beginning nor end. The more we go on searching, discovering, the more we realize this is not the end. Then what is that we have discovered as being? Just now I told you, beginning is the end of everything. I can give an example. You want to know the beginning of a river. What is the beginning of this river? When you go on searching and searching and surveying, then finally found out, oh, there's a rock or the hill, the water dripping from that bottom of this rock, this is the beginning of the correct river. This covers the beginning of the river. You say you discover. Then another group says, no, that is not the beginning. How this water? From comfort. So they wanted to investigate how this water, or where it comes from. climbing hills and rocks and various other places are found out. The water accumulated water on the top of the hill or the rocks, dropping, dripping. There is how the beginning. That is not the beginning and the top. Another group says, how this water accumulated on the top of these rocks or the hill? There are not being a force for that problem. Then they found out, oh, the rainwater is a force, not that. They say, oh, I need it now. Then another group says, how this rainwater only is? There must be a force for it. Right. Sun rays evaporated the water from this earth. Then cut the clouds and poured out as rain. The water from the same river that we are finally searching the beginning of this river. But the water from the same river again dropped into the same. We do not know that. Then there is a beginning. That is why everything in Buddhism introduced as circle. We. Because neither beginning nor end. Now see the circle here. You started to find out the beginning of the river, here he had come back to the same river. The life was satisfied in life. So, we find out the beginning. Historically, geographically, or scientifically, we find out. But that is not the beginning. Behind this beginning, nobody knows what are the other causes. That is why the Buddha says there is no beginning. Personal reference. First class philosopher, Western philosopher, agnostic or free thinker, who criticize and condemn and attack every religion. He says, those who think that there is a beginning here in this world actually are in the dark. There is no reason for us to think if we can understand what this world is. Then he says, among the founders of all these religions, I respect only one man, the Buddha. Why? He is the only religious teacher who never pointed out the beginning of the world, this world coming to exist in a certain time or created by so and so, he is an utter human wonder. But the founders of other religions
have said that there is a beginning.
But when you study science, we can understand there are things are not correct. So it shows how poor their understanding capacity about this world. The Buddha knew what this world is. That is why we need to say, this is the beginning of the world. I remember one day when I was giving a talk, I mentioned that the Buddha did not point out the beginning of the world. After my talk, one person asked, I really cannot understand why Buddha did not reveal the beginning of the world. Then I thought, if there is no beginning, how can you point out? There must be a beginning. One day, a preacher was giving a talk about creation. He started to tell others, at the beginning, when God started to create heaven and earth.
Somebody suddenly got up and asked, may I know what he was doing before he started to create this heaven and earth?
Then the preacher said, you know what was he doing at that time? At that time, he was creating heaven for those who aren't this kind of Christian. Because there is no answer to this question. So, my dear friend, the Buddhist attitude, I mentioned this earlier, not to worry, not to waste your valuable time by thinking who created this world, how this world came into existence. By knowing that, you never develop your moral, spiritual, religious way of life. To find out the purpose of your life, that is why Buddha was so interested. For curiosity, we want to know so many things. Actually, you could manage to find out something. Now, chance that, according to his theory of evolution, anthropology, he discovered something. The origin of human life. The people are not in the Buddhist attitude regarding this origin. He started his beginning from amoeba. One cell. The life which appears in the water. He discovered this. Right. Then started to move on. Going on, changing, developing. Today he stands here like human beings. He is right. But many other religions who believe that God created this human life at once like this had a big shock. This theory of evolution. They had a losing battle up to 1950. In the end, they had to surrender, but by twisting and changing. How did it change? Now, according to them, this earth and this human life may be 6 to 7,000 years old. You read the whole book. Not more than that. But after this discovery, they have given different interpretations. Here, according to our religious language, 1,000 years means few million years. See how clear it is? But they have not given this interpretation before this theory of evolution came into existence. Because they have no animal records. But we never face this problem. What? Here, Charles Darwin has discovered, as those people have discovered the beginning of the river, from anima. But he doesn't know anything behind the anima. What are the sources and energies and factors and energies? He has no knowledge. Not only that. He worked only one particular track. Elements. Fossils. Depend on fossils and history and geography. How changes have taken place from amoeba up to human beings. He has his power to prove. But he had no idea whatsoever. Why? Different forms of living beings come into existence with different mentality, different character, different behavior. Why some are cruel and wicked and cunning and dangerous? Why some are good and kind and understanding and religious? He is the God. That means he has no knowledge about karma. How mental energies change according to the mental attitude and way of thinking, he has no knowledge. with anthropology, but only one method. Sanskrit found out only one method. But the Buddhism explained further beyond that limits, which others could not understand. So there is no beginning, there is no end, why universe is infinite. Living beings always exist in this universe. And never disappear from any part of the universe. After death, rebirth again takes place somewhere else according to that person's mentality, way of life, attachments or inclinations or hopes or faith. So this is going on as repeated birth and death, life in coming to existence and appearance and disappearance. Then what is the Buddha's interpretation about this appearance? He says, there are four elements, whether life or planets or plants or any other object. When these four elements combine together with so many kinds of energy, for certain energies we have no name, and we do not know how they work. Recently, Newton found out gravity. Before that, people never had the idea of gravity. And how many unknown energies are there in this universe? So, according to the Buddha, heat, solidity, fluid, and motion, or gas. These four elements, again combined with the existing radiant energy, when all these things join together as a bundle, different forms come into existence. If there is a mind, so mental energy or karmic energy, then that mental energy also joins with this bundle. Then the life comes into existence because of this community. So he mentioned five factors there. One particular factor or one particular force cannot produce anything in this world. Those five factors, Kandaniyama, Kikaniyama, Uttaniyama, Vijaniyama, Dhamaniyama, Niyama means factors. These five factors must be there for life to come into existence. Otherwise, important. First thing, there must be a mind. Whether humans or animals or any other kind of living being, there must be a mind. If there is no mind, it is impossible to produce or condition a life. So mental energy is the first step. Second factor, in that mental energy, there must be karmic energy. What is this karmic energy? This is called polluted mental energy. Mental pollution is there. Because there is conviction, there is craving, so mental pollution. Again, you destroy others' life. You disturb others with anger, jealousy, greed, and various evil thoughts in your mind. There you have polluted your mind again. This is called bad karma, that is called good karma. Good karma and bad karma both pollute the purity of the mind. this kind of karmic energy must be there in that mental level. Now, becoming a Buddha or Arahant means that polluted mental energy, such as good karma or bad karma, completely stops. Eradicates from the mind. After that, no more reason for it. Because there are no cravings, no attachment, no anger, no jealousy. Mind is completely free. No evil. True condition. Third drama. Bijanya. BG. Same meaning. Germinal order. That means some sort of germ must be there. Otherwise, mental energy and karmic energy cannot produce a life. This general order is the cosmic energy, external cosmic energy. You can understand this. Fourth one, seek by factor of feelings. For everything, there are little feelings.